Good morning. This is Dan Cohen with Baker Donelson. Thank you for joining us this morning. Baker Donelson is an AmLaw 100 law firm with 20 offices, and we have a dedicated team of about 30 attorneys who are experienced with a variety of higher education matters who are dedicated to serving the legal needs of higher education institutions. I am the head of the higher education team, and I've worked on a number of campuses as well in athletics and in legal capacities. And if interested, I understand that my bio is linked on the left side of the screen right above the Q&A section. And for those of you who have been on these webinars before, as you know, you can click on that the Q&A section in order to submit questions throughout the program, and I'd encourage you to do so. Also, for those of you who have not been on these webinars before, we will make the PowerPoint available afterwards. So just to get started here, we're going to keep the agenda relatively short because I think each one of these points is going to take a little bit of time to go through. Of course, there are lots and lots of legal issues facing NCA institutions, including, you know, and junior colleges and other colleges as well, including concussion lawsuits, other health and safety issues. But right now, we want to focus in on some of the biggest legal challenges that have been coming to colleges and universities in regard to athletics matters. So let's start with the one that's in the news the most. That's challenges to amateurism. The recurrent narrative in the media is that big-time college athletics generates big-time revenues, and that's led to a slew of plaintiffs, attorneys, and student athletes just suing the NCAA and athletic conferences and individual schools over the last several years. O'Bannon is the case that's generated the most media attention, but there are several other current and recently resolved cases that you should know about. So we want to bring you up to speed on what's transpired over the last school year, and of course more recently as well. Most of the resolved lawsuits have fallen short, but the attacks on the NCAA amateurism model are far from over. So most challenges to the NCAA's amateurism model begins with the same concept. I should get paid, and I should get paid because of, you know, pick your argument. So it started, or most prominently, was the most prominent start was O'Bannon versus NCAA, and it devolved into a discussion of antitrust law. You know, this all started when former UCLA basketball star Ed O'Bannon saw his avatar in a college basketball video game produced by EA Sports, and he thought, I should get paid for my image. His lawsuit morphed quite a bit on its way to trial in 2014, including the settlement of all such video game avatar claims for a combined $60 million. Between EA Sports, Collegiate Licensing Company, and the NCAA. So after that settlement of kind of the pure commercial use of names, images, and likenesses in the video game context, it primarily left antitrust claims standing. So at trial, the plaintiffs argued that the NCAA's amateurism rules were an illegal restraint on trade in what amounted to a multi-billion dollar industry, and that because they were a restraint on trade, it violated antitrust laws. After trial, a couple of years ago now, in 2014, Judge Claudia Wilkin in California held that while the NCAA's rules had some pro-competitive benefits, there were violations of antitrust law. So accordingly, she ordered really two remedies. One, she ordered that the NCAA not be allowed to prohibit universities from providing athletes financial aid up to their full cost of attendance. And by the time she had ruled, that was something that D1 schools were already permitted to do. And she also ruled that the NCAA could not stop universities from setting up trust funds for athletes to compensate them for use of their names, images, and likenesses, which commonly is referred to just by the shorthand NIL. And Judge Wilkin capped this NIL amount at $5,000 per student. So the more recent event is that it was appealed up to the Ninth Circuit. On September 30th, so during this academic year that we're just completing, the Ninth Circuit ruled and really largely mooted Judge Wilkin's ruling. It affirmed, of course, that the NCAA is not above antitrust laws, stating, quote, although we agree with the Supreme Court and our sister circuits that many of the NCAA's amateurism rules are likely to be pro-competitive, we hold that those same rules are not exempt from antitrust scrutiny. Rather, they must be analyzed under what's called the rule of reason, close quote. And so the Ninth Circuit then applied that rule. And you know, rather than try to paraphrase it, I think the Ninth Circuit was actually quite clear. So I'm going to read you several key passages from that Ninth Circuit opinion. In regard to that old NCAA restriction that prevented athletic scholarships from paying all costs of attendance, that item that had been mooted by the time Judge Wilkin did rule based on NCAA legislation. But in regard to that old restriction, the Ninth Circuit Court said, quote, "We agree with the NCAA that as a general matter, courts should not use antitrust law to make marginal adjustments to broadly reasonable market restraints. The particular restraint at issue here, however, the grant and aid cap that the NCAA set below the cost of attendance, is not such a restraint," meaning reasonable restraint. "To the contrary, the evidence at trial showed that the grant and aid cap has no relation whatsoever to the pro-competitive purposes of the NCAA. By the NCAA's own standards, student-athletes remain amateurs as long as any money paid to them goes to cover legitimate educational expenses. Thus, in here holding that setting the grant and aid cap at students' full cost of attendance is a substantially less restrictive alternative under the rule of reason, we," meaning the court, "are not declaring that courts are free to micromanage organizational rules or to strike down largely beneficial market restraints with impunity. Rather, our affirmance of this aspect of the district court's decision should be taken to establish only that whereas here the restraint is patently and inexplicably stricter than is necessary to accomplish its pro-competitive objectives, then an antitrust court can and should invalidate it and order it replaced with a less restrictive alternative," close quote. So it was the fact that there was no pro-competitive benefit in not paying student athletes full educational expenses that really caught the Ninth Circuit's eye. But then as the Ninth Circuit turned to the NIL trust fund payments, the Ninth Circuit took a very hard line because those were non-educational payments. So to quote from the court, in regard to these NIL trust fund payments, the court said, quote, "The question is whether the alternative of allowing students to be paid NIL compensation unrelated to their educational expenses is virtually as effective in preserving amateurism as not allowing compensation. We cannot agree that a rule permitting schools to pay students pure cash compensation and a rule forbidding them from paying NIL compensation are both equally effective in promoting amateurism and preserving consumer demand. Both we and the district court agree that the NCAA's amateurism rule has pro-competitive benefits. But in finding that paying students cash compensation would promote amateurism as effectively as not paying them, the district court ignored that not paying student athletes is precisely what makes them amateurs. So having found that amateurism is an integral part of the NCAA's market, the district court cannot plausibly conclude that being a poorly paid professional collegiate athlete is virtually as effective for that market as being an amateur." The court continued, "The difference between offering student athletes education-related compensation and offering them cash sums untethered to educational expenses is not minor. It is a quantum leap. Once that line is crossed," and I'll pause here, this is really where the court started to preview not just what happened in O'Bannon, but also started to preview the next line of cases that's coming before Judge Wilkin and other judges across the court. The Ninth Circuit said, "Once that line is crossed, that quantum leap into paying cash sums untethered to educational expenses, quote, we see no basis for returning to a rule of amateurism and no defined stopping point. We have little doubt that plaintiffs would continue to challenge the arbitrary limit imposed by the district court until they had captured the full value of their NIL. At that point, the NCAA will have surrendered its amateurism principles entirely and transitioned from a particular brand of football to minor league status," close quote. So this clearly seems to signal a strong and preemptive pushback by the Ninth Circuit against this next wave of antitrust cases that are coming. The final O'Bannon Ninth Circuit opinion, I mean, it still remains a mixed bag. It says that the NCAA and its rules still are subject to antitrust scrutiny. So that's not something that the NCAA is thrilled about, and it had some other bad comments for purposes of the NCAA's amateurism model. So the NCAA has chosen to appeal. And of course, the O'Bannon plaintiffs have appealed because, well, frankly, they're not left with a whole lot. The only thing that they emerged with, other than some good language for the next rounds of cases, the only thing they emerged with was the right to receive scholarships up to their full cost of attendance, which NCAA legislation had taken care of before Judge Wilkin even ruled. So we're off to the Supreme Court. So the next big case that's coming is Jenkins versus the NCAA. So it takes this idea that the NCAA is subject to antitrust laws. Okay, so now what? Well, Jenkins is really, it goes by a couple of different names because it's actually really a consolidation of multiple cases that were filed throughout the country challenging on antitrust grounds the NCAA's caps on scholarships in various forms, in the provision of financial aid in various forms, or the free market opportunity to be paid sums untethered to educational expenses. So the original Jenkins case covered football and men's basketball players in the Power Five conference. It's being the name of the plaintiff is Jenkins, but it's being directed by attorney Jeffrey Kessler, and he's the lawyer who helped the NFL players win free agency several years ago. So this same case is often called the Kessler case because the lawyer is more prominent than any of the student athletes who are the named plaintiffs. So this original Jenkins complaint claims that the value of any individual student athlete scholarship has been illegally capped by agreement between NCAA members in the form of NCAA legislation. And they argue that if student athlete compensation was not so capped, some student athletes would be able to receive offers well in excess of what the NCAA currently allows. So, I mean, at its core, the Jenkins case really demands a collegiate system of recruiting that would be similar to free agency. No restrictions. Jenkins, what is now pending in multi-district litigation in California before Judge Wilkin, as I said, is a consolidation of multiple cases from around the country that voiced similar allegations and claims. Another formerly prominent case that has been pulled into this MDL or multi-district litigation involves Shawnee Alston. That's a former West Virginia football player who filed a lawsuit covering football, men's basketball, and women's basketball players in the 10 FBS conferences and the WAC, the Western Athletic Conference. So that case also began with an argument that the NCAA and the conferences violated antitrust law by capping the value of athletic scholarships below the actual cost of attendance at those conferences' member institutions, but it also more broadly challenged the NCAA scholarship caps as anti-competitive, as without a cap, schools would be competing against each other more broadly for student-athletes' services. As I said, there were others that have now been consolidated here before Judge Welkin. Other plaintiffs with similar claims that have been pulled in include a case brought by former Minnesota and Northern Colorado football player Kendall Gregory McGee, another former West Virginia player Nick Kindler, former Tulane cornerback Alex Lorisella, and a class led by former Florida player Sharif Floyd. Again, all of these are alleging that the NCAA, alleging in some form that the NCAA and its member schools are a cartel, in essence, that has illegally capped the value of scholarships. So these cases have been consolidated really for purposes of pretrial matters, discovery, et cetera. But ultimately, the group led by attorney Jeffrey Kessler wants the Jenkins trial at the end of the day to stand on its own because its scope does differ from the other cases in going a step farther. Really, the Kessler case, or the original Jenkins case, seeks to end all financial restrictions on college athletes. So as I mentioned, the case is pending before Judge Wilkin. In December, the most recent substantive move by the court, she certified three classes of student athletes. So it's not just the named plaintiffs standing alone, but rather she has consolidated three classes of student athletes whose claims who would be affected by the resolution of this case. Those three certified classes are all FBS football players and all men's and women's D1 basketball players who have received full scholarships since the litigation started. That certification by Judge Wilkin was over the NCAA's objections. The NCAA had argued that elimination of the NCAA's rules would, quote, be sure to produce vigorous recruitment and possibly substantial payments to the most talented athletes, the group that allegedly includes the named plaintiffs, but there can be no doubt that the requested injunction also would lead to the reduction or elimination of scholarships and athletic opportunities for many of the thousands of less renowned student athletes whom the named plaintiffs also claim to represent. Was there a class conflict in the way that the plaintiffs requested and Judge Wilkins certified these classes? There may well be a conflict, but nonetheless, that was the ruling of Judge Wilkins back in December. So for a moment on the substance, Jenkins essentially seeks a free market for college football and basketball players to seek to be paid. It would seek to strip the NCAA of the right to set compensation limits for college athletes at the mere full cost of attendance. And then presumably without a cap, universities would be pressured to pay student athletes scholarships or cash at whatever fair market value they could demand. It would just be a complete competition in which student athletes would be competing for payments rather than competing, so that universities would not as much be competing based on the unique benefits of their campuses, of the educational programs that they offer, et cetera, their coaching staffs. It would become much more of a financial consideration in recruiting. So the Jenkins plaintiffs, Jeffrey Kessler and the other attorneys, can argue from O'Bannon that the NCAA is subject to antitrust scrutiny. And in taking part of the O'Bannon opinion, they can argue that the NCAA's anti-competitive rules are subject to being stricken. However, at the end of the day, in order to prevail, the plaintiffs would have to overcome that Ninth Circuit language that I read before from O'Bannon, which upholds amateurism and the NCAA's restrictions on the payment of sums untethered to educational expenses. So based on that language, just last week, the NCAA filed a motion for judgment on the pleadings on this issue. The NCAA seeks to have the case thrown out entirely. Since the Ninth Circuit has ruled that aspects of these exact provisions the plaintiffs in Jenkins would seek to have stricken, the Ninth Circuit actually ruled that they have pro-competitive elements and that untethering payments from the educational mission would be a significant problem and would undo amateurism. Additionally, the NCAA's motion also included a theory of collateral estoppel or issue preclusion. Basically, what that means is that the NCAA said that all male student athletes who were certified in this litigation, the Jenkins litigation, they were already parties to the O'Bannon litigation. They were protected by the class in that suit, and as such, aside from the precedential effect of the Ninth Circuit opinion, those individual plaintiffs, those individual class members in Jenkins, also are directly bound by the earlier decision. They can't argue it a second time. They already lost that exact issue as being class members under O'Bannon. So stay tuned on this one. We'll see what Judge Wilkin does with it. And as we can tell, ultimately, whatever happens, it's going to go up to the Ninth Circuit, and then we can probably anticipate requests for cert from the Supreme Court. So those are the most prominent cases, but there are a bunch of others. And just very quickly, there's a group of plaintiffs' attorneys that has filed three cases in the Southern District of Indiana by the NCAA's offices. All three of these are pending before the same judge. There are many other cases across the country, but these three tend to get some more media play than the kind of one-off cases that are filed. So this string of cases began with John Rock. He's a former Gardner Webb quarterback, and he filed an antitrust suit in 2012 alleging that he had been recruited by both FBS and FCS schools, but he alleges that he did not receive any FBS scholarship offers because of two NCAA rules that he's now challenging. One, the NCAA's former ban on multi-year scholarships, which is sometimes referred to as the one-year rule, and also the NCAA's cap on scholarships overall. So John Rock ended up enrolling at Gardner Webb, an FCS school, and then he alleges that he was forced out by his coach after 3 years, which he says could not have happened if he had been on a four-year or even a five-year scholarship with a redshirt year there. He ended up, I think, turning professional or signing a contract so that his NCAA eligibility actually expired after the third year. He contends that the labor market exists, that a labor market exists for antitrust purposes, consisting of NCAA D1 football student athletes, and that the athletes compete for positions, and the schools in turn compete to recruit the athletes with pay that consists of these scholarships, and obviously the other things, the academic programs, the access, the training facilities, the coaching, et cetera. So according to Rock, the NCAA's scholarship limits artificially decreased the supply and quality of scholarships that were available to him and to the other student athletes that were similarly situated as he attempted to get class cert. And so, as I said, he attempted to bring a class action on behalf of students who were recruited by at least one FBS school and did not receive their initial scholarship throughout the entirety of their undergraduate education. Now, he included some carve-outs, and so ultimately the way that he tried to construct the class was fatal to his position. And in March, this very past March 2016, the court denied class cert. While the case has not yet been dismissed, it kind of effectively may end the case since Rock would be forced to go it alone, really, so his maximum potential recovery is unattractive for his attorneys when you're talking about a single individual. The court refused to grant to certify the class for numerous reasons, but primarily it seemed like it was because he could not show that Rock could not show that he was recruited as defined by his own proposed class petition, and also because he had no NCAA eligibility at the time that he filed the suit. And that last point ends up being pretty significant as we roll these cases forward. It's not necessarily determinative of the other cases, since he actually signed a contract and eliminated his ability to be eligible, where some of these other plaintiffs simply, their eligibility expired. So as this Rock case was being chipped away at by the NCAA, there was another individual by the name of Pugh who tried to intervene and take the place of Rock to keep that case alive. Meanwhile, that happened in January of this year. Meanwhile, the same individual back in November of 2015, just 2 months earlier, he had already filed, his same attorneys had already filed a parallel case in the same district pending before the same judge. So clearly he was able to pursue the claims on his own regardless of what happened with Rock. The judge rejected Pugh intervening in Rock and is letting the Pugh case roll forward on its own. The NCAA has filed a motion to dismiss on several grounds, but a significant one is the fact that Pugh had no remaining NCAA eligibility at the time that he sued. So we'll see how the court rules on that motion to dismiss. Depe is another one brought on the heels of the other two, same plaintiff's attorneys, same court, same judge, and really largely the same theories. Depe is a former Northern Illinois walk-on punter who claims that the NCAA's transfer restrictions violate antitrust laws. So that's kind of the tweak on this one and why it deserves its own bullet point. In his lawyer's own words, to just quote from it, quote, the NCAA's year-in-residence requirement penalizes D1 football players from switching schools. Without the ability to play immediately, transferring student athletes are less attractive prospects and less likely to secure scholarships from their new schools, close quote. He also argues that the NCAA's caps on the number of scholarships are horizontal restraints on trade that reduce the cost of production for D1 football games and therefore unfairly prevents players from getting more compensation and, of course, from switching schools. Not surprisingly, NCAA has also filed a motion to dismiss on this one. It argues that its transfer rules are pro-competitive and they're necessary for amateurism. So the court's got those two motions to dismiss pending, same judge, in regard to both Pugh and Depe. But, all right, so enough of the kind of thick antitrust discussion. Let's talk about the underlying compensation theories. Because underlying all this antitrust legalese, there's this underlying presumption that there's going to be a future payday. So if the student athletes can get through antitrust, you know, theoretically student athletes can be compensated. Many of these cases look towards the broadcast TV market as a source for potential compensation, as, you know, NCAA schools reap billions of dollars from their TV contracts, and student-athletes' names and images are obviously broadcast during these televised games. This is a significant area for fighting. It's one thing to chip away at antitrust rules. It's another one to actually, you know, be entitled to payment as a result of it. And in fact, the Jenkins case has been bogged down in discovery fights for several months over whether the plaintiffs should be permitted to receive the defendant's multiple TV contracts. So, meanwhile, we've had other cases that have joined the issue, that have gotten down to the right of publicity and whether student athletes actually could get paid for being on broadcast games and therefore realize some payment for use of their names, images, and likenesses in those games as they are broadcast, and for which the NCAA and its member institutions receive, you know, tons and tons of dollars. So Javon Marshall versus ESPN is a recent case from during this current academic year that gets to this underlying substantive concept of paying student athletes for the use of their names and images in profitable game broadcasts. And really, at the end of the day, this Marshall case does significant damage to student athletes' cause. So in Marshall, former student athletes claimed that they were entitled to compensation for use of their images without permission in these televised games based on their so-called right to publicity or right to control and profit off of the use of their own recognized image. But the judge, Judge Sharp in Nashville, rejected this argument and dismissed the case outright. While Judge Sharp said that there's little doubt that top-level college football and basketball is a big business, he noted that his role through the court was not to determine whether college student athletes should be paid for the revenue they help generate, but rather, quote, the court's sole task is to determine whether present plaintiffs have alleged sufficient facts or stated a viable claim that they are entitled to monetary compensation because they play in televised games. The court finds that plaintiffs have not done so and under any of the theories that they set forth, close quote. So Judge Sharp walked through the analysis and concluded that generally the law does not recognize the right of publicity in newsworthy events, including sports broadcasts. Really, the focus on NIL payments and rights comes from commercial uses, the use of someone else's name to promote a product in advertisements or commercial purposes. But in regard to newsworthy events, including sports broadcasts, Judge Sharp said, quote, virtually all courts in jurisdictions that have decided the matter under the respective laws, so it transcends just Tennessee law, which is where this case was pending. Virtually all courts and jurisdictions that have decided this matter under their respective laws have held that participants in sporting events do not have a right of publicity under the common law, close quote. So, and as I said, that can be differentiated from purely commercial enterprises like, say, the sales of players' jerseys or the use of their images in for-profit video games. For those of you who followed the O'Bannon trial as it was playing out, there was all kinds of live tweets back in the summer of 2014 before Judge Wilkin. You may have seen that Judge Wilkin simply just didn't understand this concept during the O'Bannon trial, and that portion of the opinion was kind of, well, mangled. There was no reason for that issue to be rejoined later on, but I will say, if you're interested in this underlying right of publicity, take a look at the Marshall opinion. Judge Sharp really analyzed it pretty clearly, I think. There have been a number of other cases that parallel this. The Eighth Circuit just ruled in February in a case called Dreyer versus the NFL, which held that former NFL players could not recover for the use of their likenesses in prior game footage or highlights. That one actually turned on copyright law. But the same concept was that any state law publicity rights they might have had would be preempted by copyright law. Copyright law, in that case, I believe the analysis kind of paralleled it with First Amendment rights of the broadcasters to create a unique work that was copyrightable, and the copyright federal law trumped the state law right of publicity that the players might have had, never mind the fact that it was a newsworthy event, and therefore there probably was not compensation available for use of the name, image, and likeness. For the same reason that we don't pay, you know, the man or woman who shows up on the 6 o'clock news. All right. Looking at other underlying compensation theories, I think one thing that's pretty interesting. I think one thing that's pretty interesting is the potential expansion of. So while for the most part, the student athletes are not doing well substantively on their antitrust style claims and the right to get paid for broadcasts. On the other hand, this idea that maybe they should be paid for their use of name, image, likeness in commercial enterprises is becoming more and more widely accepted. So you start with the EA Sports CLC and NCAA settlements for use of the name, image, and likeness in video games. As I said, $60 million ended up flowing to NCAA student athletes as a result of those settlements. But surprisingly, now we've got not only is the NCAA considering maybe is there a way that we can allow for third parties to compensate student athletes for their names, images, and likenesses in commercial enterprises, but the Knight Commission is actually stepping forward and looking at this. The Knight Commission very clearly had previously opposed paying college athletes. But in May, earlier this month, it signaled that it might be open to supporting rules changes that would allow players to profit off of their own name, image, and likeness. The commission considered arguments that maybe the NCAA should eliminate the current rules that barred athletes from profiting off of their NIL and replace them with a new set of rules that would allow players to secure endorsement deals and other forms of compensation. They tried to build in the amateurism concepts and protections. Perhaps student athletes could receive payment for their autographs or for appearing on TV or radio shows. Again, the commercial enterprise, not the game broadcast. But these types of rules, if the NCAA decided to go forward, conceivably would allow student athletes to enter into group licensing agreements for, say, video games or jersey sales. And then maybe the money earned from such agreements could be kept in a trust fund until the player graduates. So at this point, it's just something the Knight Commission is considering. It's newsworthy because it sounds like a huge change. Also take a step back and think about, okay, who actually has the wherewithal to profit from the use of their name, images, and likenesses? And testimony before the Knight Commission suggested that maybe there were only 50 student athletes per year who had enough name recognition to actually profit off of their likenesses in any sort of really meaningful way. So we'll wait and see if the Knight Commission decides to make a recommendation in this direction. So, again, a lot of the media focuses on kind of the heavy, the meaty antitrust cases, we also have these other underlying compensation theories. And a big one involves employment law. Are student athletes employees of a university? Is there any way that they could get paid as employees? So the first challenge, which is now about a year old, involved the NLRB. So last July, still within my calendar year, within the last 12 months, last July the NLRB dismissed a petition by Northwestern football players who were seeking to unionize. It really was more of a fair catch than anything else. It wasn't the NLRB denied jurisdiction. It effectively denied the student athlete's claim that they were university employees under the NLRA, but really it was more of a practical recognition that the NLRB could only reach about 17 of 128 FBS football programs because they were at private schools and therefore were subject to the NLRB's grasp. So really this was just, it would not serve any competitive purpose if the NLRB only authorized unionization at 17 of 128 FBS schools. So it just kind of punted on the issue. But the bottom line is that under the NLRA, student athletes were not recognized as employees. A case that had the potential to do a whole lot more damage was filed in late 2014 by a former University of Houston women's soccer player, Samantha Sakos. She claimed that she was employed by virtue of being a student athlete and being controlled, her schedule and her activities being controlled to a large extent by her coaches. So she claimed that she was employed by the University of Houston as an unpaid student athlete. Of course, this was filed as an attempted class action, so she further claimed that the NCAA and all of its 300-plus D1 schools conspired to violate the FLSA and misclassify all D1 athletes as unpaid labor. So basically, she was arguing that she and all D1 student athletes should be entitled to minimum wage and overtime payments for the athletic work that they performed as school employees. So those of you who follow the FLSA know that the terms are extraordinarily broad. This suit had the potential to do some real damage because it's so easy to be considered an employee under the FLSA. But as this case worked its way through the courts, it ran into some serious trouble. The first one was just state sovereign immunity grounds. Each state had its own circumstances, and the plaintiff's attorneys decided that rather than fight this from jurisdiction to jurisdiction and face, 50 different state sovereign immunity motions to dismiss, the plaintiffs just kind of threw up their hands and they dismissed all public D1 colleges and universities, which included the University of Houston. So that required Ms. Sackos to be replaced as the lead plaintiff by Lauren Anderson and other University of Penn student-athletes, private schools. So Judge William Lawrence ruled on this case in February. He held that even though the application of the FLSA's employment terms are intended to be extraordinarily broad, he rejected the plaintiff's argument that student-athletes could be treated, well, first, like interns, saying that the Department of Labor guidance related to interns fails to capture the nature of the relationship between student-athletes and their schools. Instead, Judge Lawrence explained the ultimate inquiry is whether student-athletes are the primary beneficiary of their athletic activity after weighing all circumstances. So with respect to the plaintiffs, the ones who were left standing from the University of Pennsylvania, the judge noted that, quote, generations of Penn students have vied for the opportunity to play for the school's teams with no thought of compensation, close quote. So there was no thought of wages, not even the prospect of an athletic scholarship, because, of course, Penn's an Ivy League school with no athletic scholarships. So Judge Lawrence continued, quote, this demonstrates unequivocally that the students at Penn who chose to participate in sports, whether NCAA sports, club sports, or intramural sports, as part of their educational experience, do so because they view it as primarily beneficial to them, close quote, primarily beneficial to the student athlete. As a result, looking at the relationship as a whole, the university, the college, is not the primary beneficiary of the relationship, which undermines the employment, the purported employment relationship under the FLSA. Judge Lawrence continued. He further noted that the DOL, the Department of Labor, has never taken the position that student-athletes could be employees. And he wrote, quote, the fact that thousands of unpaid college athletes exist on college campuses every year is not a secret, and yet the DOL has not taken any action to apply the FLSA to them, close quote. So instead, he quoted DOL guidance that declared that interscholastic activities, including athletics, are typically conducted primarily for the benefit of participants as part of their educational opportunities and are not work under the FLSA. As a result, they do not result in an employee-employer relationship between the student and the school or institution, close quote. So this is really a major blow for student-athletes' efforts to be compensated beyond their financial aid awards. Obviously, we still have this NIL for commercial use theory out there. But here within the last calendar year, within the last 12 months, we've had a major hit to their ability to recover for use of their name, images, and likenesses in broadcasts, a major hit to whether antitrust-style claims could reach beyond educational-style expenses, and now under two different rulings under the NLRA and the FLSA, they're not entitled to be compensated as if they were employees. As you would assume, this case, the Sackos, now known as Anderson case, is currently being appealed to the Seventh Circuit. So next steps. I think the main ones that are really merit watching, I'd say we need to keep an eye on the Supreme Court review for the O'Bannon decision, which obviously has been argued by both sides, has been appealed by both sides. I think it's definitely worth watching this Jenkins case, but whatever Judge Wilkin rules on it, that won't be the end of it. And of course, we know that no matter what, with enterprising plaintiff's attorneys, we always need to be on the lookout for the next big case. All right, so turning to Title IX. Obviously, Title IX has been in the news these days because there's been such a significant increase in Title IX sexual misconduct cases on campuses throughout the country. And just to kind of give you the agenda for this next section here, just put that up on the screen. There are currently over 200 OCR investigations pending against colleges and universities, and the Obama administration actually requested a $30 million increase in funding for the Office for Civil Rights to help increase that, to help handle that increased caseload. So OCR could hire about 150 new full-time positions for the office. And really, right now this is an athletics update. I don't want to spend too much time talking about these Title IX sexual misconduct cases. But of course, we've got the confluence of media interests. The media is very interested in sexual misconduct cases, and of course they're very interested in big-time college sports. So there have been a number of very high-profile cases. You know, for example, the University of Oregon, Baylor's in the news right now because purportedly its high-profile president, Ken Starr, is being asked to step down. We had the University of Tennessee case, which generated a lot of headlines right around the Super Bowl because Peyton Manning was mentioned based on a 20-year-old incident from when he was a student there. And in the media attention, the substantive claims from the UT case got lost somewhat because the media was more interested in what Peyton might or might not have done two decades ago. But suffice it to say that the current allegations are very serious and remain pending. The takeaway from those sexual misconduct cases is that universities must take sexual assault allegations very seriously. They must educate students and student athletes about sexual misconduct and concepts like affirmative consent and the effect of incapacitation that can occur with alcohol and drugs. And then colleges and universities must act swiftly and fairly when incidents do occur. Of course, between the media's attention on sexual misconduct and its attention on college sports, this is just an area where it's very easy to generate really bad headlines if you're not being proactive with both your preventative and your responsive on-campus sexual misconduct efforts. So I want to keep the program moving. We do a lot of work in this area. I'm happy to talk with you offline about those cases or other matters in the sexual misconduct arena if you're interested. But let's keep moving with the Title IX athletics matters. Oh, wait, I did want to mention one other case first. So perhaps the most high-profile Title IX sexual misconduct case involved Jameis Winston, the Heisman Trophy winner at FSU. According to news accounts, well, actually more than news accounts, the settlement agreement, FSU paid $950,000 to settle that Title IX lawsuit that was brought by the former student who was allegedly assaulted by Winston. But I wanted to pause here and ask a polling question. So do you think that the settlement agreement entitled the victim to receive – so I'll tell you, the settlement agreement provided that the $950,000 should be divided $700,000 and $250,000 as between the plaintiff and the plaintiff's attorneys. So please click on the polling box here. Do you think that the settlement agreement entitled the victim to receive the $700,000? Well, I'll tell you the answer. The settlement agreement actually said that the lawyers should get $700,000, the victim should get $250,000. So, in fairness, settlement agreement also said that those two groups could decide amongst themselves any reallocation that they wish to. But the message coming out of the settlement agreement language itself and the message coming out of the media attention was, hey, if you're a plaintiff's attorney, there's a lot of money to be gained by suing colleges and universities. So it just emboldens more attorneys to go after you. There have also been very high-dollar settlements for Title IX athletics claims, including related retaliation claims. There's one school that's been subject to Title IX lawsuits recently that settled with three plaintiffs, including the former director of sports medicine and two strength coaches, for $750,000 plus attorney's fees. And then they had the same school had actually settled with a former media director in 2014 for $320,000. The claims are somewhat unique, which is why I wanted to mention them briefly here. Several of those employees made far less than those amounts in wages, too, so the settlement seemed relatively high. The more recent case involved allegations of pay disparities allegedly arising from the employees' assignments to work with women's teams. They effectively argued that they were paid less than other employees doing equivalent jobs for the benefit of male student athletes. So the alleged gender discrimination actually related to those they served, not their own gender, as one of the strength coaches was actually male. And then they also alleged that athletic department officials retaliated against them when they complained about the alleged pay discrimination, which, you know, that type of claim has been around since 2005, the Roderick Jackson Supreme Court case allowed him to recover for an adverse employment action following his advocacy on behalf of his female basketball team, which means that he could claim gender discrimination unrelated to his own gender. But this case that I'm mentioning, the settled case, attempted to take that analysis a step farther, claiming that paying trainers and coaches who work with female athletes, paying them less than those who work with male athletes, reflects a devaluation of women's athletics, which affects not just women, but also men who work in women's athletics as well. So it's kind of a strange theory, but nonetheless, you see the numbers that were involved in the settlement quite high. I think the settlement that takes the cake, really, is one where a women's basketball head coach was fired after 11 consecutive losing seasons, yet she extracted a $1.25 million settlement following her termination. She claims the reason her team lost is because the university didn't support her team. Now, the university had done an internal investigation conducted by its Office of Equal Opportunity and Diversity and concluded that the coach's claims of these Title IX infractions completely lacked merit. Yet nonetheless, the university settled for $1.25 million after 11 consecutive losing seasons. These are big numbers, so it's something to pay attention to. Really, since that 2005 Roderick Jackson case, plaintiffs' attorneys have fallen in love with these Title IX retaliation claims, and as you can see, sometimes they hit pay dirt. So the message is, make sure that you're addressing these Title IX athletics issues as they're brought to your attention, and be proactive in addressing any Title IX disparities. Don't let them fester, because this is what they could become. Okay, so turning to kind of core Title IX athletics matters, aside from the retaliation type issues. While OCR obviously has focused heavily on Title IX sexual misconduct matters in recent years, there's also been a huge increase in Title IX athletics complaints and enforcement actions. According to OCR's report last April, they received almost four times the number of athletics complaints in 2013-14 as compared to just 2009-10 and 10-11 combined. So basically, it's an eightfold increase over the course of 3 or 4 years. Mass complaints have become more frequent. We're seeing conference-wide complaints. We're seeing statewide complaints. In 2015, well-known Title IX attorney Nancy Hogshead McCarr, who happened to be one of the attorneys who represented that women's basketball coach we were just talking about, well, Nancy formed a new advocacy organization that has the express purpose of going after colleges with apparent Title IX disparities. She began with a list of about 50 schools that were primarily located in the Southeast. And while that effort has not necessarily generated a ton of headlines, it's important to note that there's nothing stopping OCR or a Title IX activist or local plaintiff's attorneys from pulling any school's publicly reported EADA statistics and filing an OCR complaint based on their interpretation of the school's self-reported data. So it's important to really know your Title IX compliance status. Most of you, I'm sure, just to flip back for a sec, I'm sure most of you recognize and are familiar with the 13 program areas listed here. There aren't national statistics on compliance with the 11 equitable treatment provisions, but trust me, there are complaints out there under every one of these areas, and I would guess that all of you have at least some issues that should be addressed under the equitable treatment provisions. But what I wanted to talk about is the national statistics, because there are nationally reported statistics on the first two program areas. So first, a very quick primer in regard to the provision of equitable athletic participation opportunities. There are three different ways to comply. These are all viable. They are all acceptable alternatives. But prong one is the one that's most well known because it's objective. And each of you publicly report your compliance status each year as part of your equity in athletics or EADA report. So if a school complies with prong one, what that means is that its undergraduate male-female ratio is substantially proportionate to its male-female student-athlete ratio. And while substantial proportionality can vary depending on the size of your school and its athletics offerings, the school typically needs those ratios to be within about 2 or 3% of each other in order to comply with prong one. As I mentioned, Prong two and prong three are both totally viable. We work with schools all the time on prong two and prong three strategies to give them flexibility to step away from statistical proportionality. But, I mean, really, given the ease with which prong one proportionality statistics are reported, you would think that that's a favored way to comply, right? So let's ask a question here, see if you're still with me. We're going to set the bar really low here. Do you think that more than 20% of NCA institutions reported being within 2% of prong one proportionality in their 2014-2015 EADA reports? So I'll read that one again. Do you think more than 20% of NCAA institutions reported being within 2% of prong one proportionality in their 2014-15 EADA reports? Well, here's the answer. It's bad. Only 12%. Only 12% of all NCAA institutions were within 2% of prong one proportionality. Now, maybe 3% is good enough. That, you know, it is what it is. You're going to have to argue about that if you're ever sued or if OCR ever investigates on prong one grounds. But take a look at some of these other red statistics. 71.6% of all NCAA institutions reported that women were the underrepresented gender by more than 5%. Look at the bottom statistic. 53.9% of all NCAA institutions had women as the underfunded gender by more than 10%. I mean, that's terrible. But I'll also say that given the media attention on prong one, you would expect these numbers to be much better, yes, but the media attention also tends to be terribly uninformed. I remember there was a New York Times expose several years ago that supposedly caught a bunch of schools rigging their numbers to try to comply with prong one or move closer to prong one, but as you can see, that technique probably was unsuccessful. Not too many schools actually get there. But what bothered me about the New York Times article is that it also relies on a legally irrelevant premise. Moving closer to prong one rarely has any legal effect. Either you comply or you don't. So really, it's legally irrelevant if you are minus 8% or minus 18%. Either way, you don't comply with prong one. Although, in all honesty, you're more likely to catch a Title IX advocate's eye if you're at minus 18. But I will say, if you're one of those schools that's at minus 10 or worse, you're probably not going to be able to close the gap all the way to comply with prong one. So you're probably better off focusing on those proactive prong three compliance techniques so that you have a proactive legal defense rather than bothering to spend your capital on moving closer to but not actually reaching prong one. So this is just a visual depiction of what we've been talking about. 75% of all NCAA schools, if you're looking at women or men, being underrepresented by more than 5%. Most schools aren't there. The other object of program area involves the quality of scholarships. These statistics are also publicly reported on your EADA reports. Compliance here in the scholarship arena is subject to a strict rule. You're supposed to be within 1% your student-athlete ratio versus your athletic financial aid ratio. So OCR will accept legitimate non-discriminatory justifications for any larger disparity, but really you're supposed to be within 1%. So last polling question. In regards to Title IX scholarship compliance, do you expect women to be the underfunded gender nationally according to their aggregated 2014-2015 EADA reports? Well, so far it looks like it's a tie in terms of our voters. Nope, we think women are going to be underfunded. More votes for that one. All right, well, here's the answer. First of all, let's take a look at how many actually do comply. Remember, this is subject to a strict rule. Yes, you can look, OCR will look at legitimate non-discriminatory justifications, but only 14.6% of all NCAA schools are within that 1%, according to their own self-reported EADA statistics that are available for public consumption by every Title IX advocate in OCR. But also look just below it, the pluses and the minuses here. This is from the female student athlete's perspective. So the minus means women are underfunded, just as it meant on the last slide that women were underrepresented. So here, look at this, 62.5% of all NCAA institutions have men as the underfunded gender, by at least 1%. That's the plus. And the next line reflects that men are the underfunded gender by more than 5% at a third of all NCAA institutions, at least according to their school's self-reported EADA reports for 2014-2015. A lot of people are surprised by this statistic. I'll give you a quick visual on it. Now, I will say I expect these numbers to change in 2015-2016 and beyond as a result of full cost of attendance being implemented. But really, the takeaway here is two wrongs don't make a right. There have been several OCR cases that have held schools were simultaneously discriminating against both male and female student athletes under different provisions of Title IX. So if you're one of those schools where women are underrepresented but men are underfunded, you need to get that under control. So we're running short on time. I would just say feel free to contact me offline. We can talk about possible techniques. Or, you know, frankly, if you're not sure where your school stands, I've got all of your statistics available because I know the plaintiff's attorneys are looking at it and the activists are looking at it, so I need to look at it. So if you don't know where your school stands, just let me know and I'd be happy to tell you. So last area, very briefly, the last week, the Department of Labor issued new FLSA overtime rules. We're actually hosting a separate full one-hour webinar tomorrow on those new rules, so I hope that you all got that invitation. If you didn't, feel free to contact me. I don't want to steal thunder from tomorrow's program, but I do want to give you a quick rundown here in case you can't attend tomorrow. So big picture item, the salary threshold is doubling in order to be exempt from the overtime rules. So the old rule was about $24,000. Now it's going up to $47,000. If your employee makes less than that, they may well be entitled to overtime and minimum wage payments unless they fall under one of the exemptions. So bonuses, incentives, including commissions, actually can be included to satisfy up to 10% of the standard salary level. This is a new development. Also, through bonuses, the rule allows for employers to make catch-up payments as long as it's done quarterly and it's on a non-discretionary basis. And then this figure, this $47,000, will be updated every 3 years rather than the initially proposed annual updates. In regard to higher education specifically, one of the biggest areas involves coaches. Athletic coaches and assistant coaches may fall under the teaching exemption, which previously was unclear. If the coach's primary duty is teaching, and that includes on-field teaching, it's fine if they do some recruiting, some administrative work, some other tasks, but it must be a primary obligation of the employee to be engaged in teaching. So, you know, it's interesting the DOL here specifically stated that teaching can include the instructing of athletes and how to perform their sport. So I think that's going to help a lot of schools since we know that coaching in season is not a 40-hour job. Maybe an 80-hour job. So schools would be looking at a ton of overtime for coaches if the Department of Labor had not clarified this. Just to note, coaches who are primarily responsible for recruiting and non-teaching aspects of the job will not be exempt. Graduate students and, frankly, undergraduate students who assist as employees as well. The DOL said that if a student is engaged in research under a faculty member's supervision and in the course of obtaining a degree, the DOL will not consider them to be in an employment relationship with the school. So as such, you've got graduate and undergraduate students who will not be entitled to overtime. So, and then, of course, you know, if they were actually engaged in coaching, such that their primary duty falls under this teaching exemption, that's a separate exemption that may work. One other key that might help is the academic administrative personnel. The DOL clarified that higher education administrative personnel, such as academic counselors and advisors and others with similar responsibilities, would not be entitled to the overtime compensation if they are paid at least as much as the entrance salary for teachers at their institution. But, of course, university athletic departments have a ton of non-academic administrative employees as well, maybe recruiters, maybe lots of others. They will be eligible for overtime if they earn below that $47,000 threshold. So obviously this helps with several key employees within an athletics department, but not, for example, say, trainers and SIDs who routinely work a ton more than 40 hours per week. So you may still be looking at a substantial increase in labor costs during this next academic year, beginning July 1, even though these rules themselves don't go into effect until December. So now may be a perfect time for you to review and analyze and reclassify employees in order to comply with these final rules. So as I said, Dina Sokolow is giving a full one-hour webinar on this topic tomorrow at 3 Eastern, 2 Central, to discuss how these new overtime rules impact higher education institutions, not just athletics, as well as suggested best practices. So please feel free to email me if you need a copy of the invitation to tomorrow's webinar. So we're right at the one-hour mark. Please feel free to email me directly. My email is listed there if you have any questions, and I'd be happy to talk with you offline about any of these topics. My phone number is there as well. Feel free to give me a call, send me a text if you wish. And that is it for our program. Thanks so much for your patience. I appreciate it. We at Baker Donelson appreciate it, and we look forward to serving many of you in the future. All right, take care. Bye.